For the modern American family, frozen pizza is like manna from heaven on the average weekday night. The next time you grab your favorite frozen pizza from the freezer section at your grocery store, consider these interesting facts that help make homemade pizza like this available today. An article published in the New York Times in 1950 hailed the arrival of the precursor to the frozen pizza to the city that never sleeps. The ready-to-cook refrigerated pizza, first introduced by Leo Jouffre. These pizzas were pre-prepared, but the cooking was left to the customer. Jouffre rolled out his pizzas in Boston, and after being considerably well-received, Jouffre quickly expanded and opened a second location in Queens, New York. These original take-and-bake pies were simple, 9-inch rounds, without any special toppings aside from tomato sauce, mozzarella cheese, olive oil, and seasonings like thyme and oregano. This made them inexpensive, just 49 cents per pizza, and easy to take home and personalize. The Times suggested adding anchovies, mushrooms, bologna, or green pepper before popping them in the oven. After just 10 days of opening his second location in New York, Jouffre's company was tasked with churning out 3,000 pizzas per day. The success of this first-of-its-kind product made it clear that looking for a way to freeze pizzas for later use at home could be met with equal levels of enthusiasm.
Pizza!
Pizza!
Pizza, pizza, pizza! Everybody loves pizza!
It's a little bit tricky to get a clear picture of where the first frozen pizzas were introduced, and by whom, given that the early 1950s seemed to launch the first pizza boom, with companies popping up in different locations around the country, at more or less the same time. For instance, a newspaper ad from the Berkshire Eagle in Pittsfield, Massachusetts, mentions frozen pizzas available for purchase at Kelsey's for just 33 cents. Although it's unclear whether they were made and sold by Kelsey's, or if they were a product offered through another company. The first real mention of a frozen pizza company was in a Chicago Tribune newspaper clipping from February 1951, in which it mentions Emile DeSalvi, a quote, "band man about town who decided to shelve his music after perfecting a frozen pizza pie." That was literally the extent of the mention, and it's hard to track down more information on the pizza company in the years between 1951 and 1954, when a second Chicago Tribune clipping says that DeSalvi had sold 5 million pies in the two preceding years. Quite the impressive statistic for a new company.
Hey, we're going for pizza. Do you want to come?
Got a better idea. I'll make you some.
While enterprising entrepreneurs began selling frozen pizzas all over the place, one man, Joseph Bucci, applied for a patent for his method of making frozen pizza in 1950. In his patent application, he laments the problem of preparing and freezing pizzas that end up with a soggy or unpalatable crust because the moisture from the sauce seeps into the uncooked dough and prevents them from cooking well. His application provides a method for pre-cooking the crust with an edible sealing agent, usually tomato paste, cooked tomatoes, or tomato puree, before adding other items like cheese and toppings, and then freezing the whole pie for later baking. In his patent application, he explains how this method of freezing pizza prevents the moisture from the sauces from seeping into or affecting the dough, allowing it to rise and cook as intended. Unfortunately for Bucci, the United States is slow to grant patents, and his patent wasn't approved until 1954, long after entrepreneurs like Emile DeSalvi were making a fortune from selling frozen pizzas. At almost the exact same time as other frozen pizza entrepreneurs were beginning to sell their pies to grocery stores, Rose and Jim Totino opened a mom-and-pop pizzeria in Minneapolis called Totino's Pizza. The Italian eatery opened in 1951 and quickly sold as many as 500 pizzas per day. Due to the popularity of the pizzas, the family opened a frozen pizza plant in 1962 to support retail sales. A newspaper clipping from the Minneapolis Star Tribune in 1970 pointed out that in Minneapolis, Totino's frozen pizza accounted for 75% of all frozen pizza sales, and that the brand was quickly rising in popularity across the country, including in markets like San Antonio, Milwaukee, and St. Louis. In 1975, Rose Totino sold the brand to Pillsbury and continued to work with the company to help perfect the frozen pizza crust. In 1978, Totino's became the first nationally distributed frozen pizza, and with the introduction of its crisp crust in 1978, followed by the patent of said crust in 1979, a feature that's still used in Totino's products today. And it's not like the popularity of Totino's has died down. According to their website, they continue to sell around 1 million party pizzas per day. And their Totino's pizza rolls are America's best-selling hot snack. For good reason, in 2008, Rose Totino was inducted into the Minnesota Inventors Hall of Fame. The United States government's involvement in the food industry is necessary, but it can also be a tricky business given how many parties are involved. According to an article published in the Washington Post in 1983, the United States Department of Agriculture tried to get involved in the frozen pizza industry by requiring frozen pizzas with meat to have a certain percentage of real cheese included in every pizza, but literally only those pies that included meat. Why, you might ask? Because the USDA could only make decisions about products that contain meat. the Food and Drug Administration was responsible for decisions regarding meatless or cheese pizzas. But in 1983, with a surplus of dairy in the country growing, the organization started looking for ways to encourage sales of dairy to other companies. At the time, frozen pizzas only needed to include 10% real cheese on every pie. 90% could be imitation cheese. Realizing this, the USDA proposed that all meat pizzas needed to include 12% cheese topping, with 50% of that cheese topping coming from real cheese. The reaction by food manufacturers was swift. Thousands of people wrote to say the proposed change would cost a fortune. On the other hand, the dairy industry was in full support. Ultimately, the USDA backed off, electing not to make any changes to the frozen pizza customers had come to know and love. When you walk down the frozen pizza aisle of your grocery store, you'll likely recognize many of the brands. Totino's, of course, is a favorite. DiGiorno surely stands out. And in all likelihood, you're familiar with Red Baron pizzas, too. What you might not realize, though, is that Red Baron has been gracing freezer shelves for more than 40 years. Having first been introduced by Schwan's Consumer Brands in 1976, a 2016 article published in Business Wire highlights the 40-year anniversary of the Red Baron, pointing out that it's a brand, quote, trusted in 27 million households annually. All in all, though, you might be drawn to Red Baron pizzas out of nostalgia and familiarity with the packaging, rather than the taste. Most frozen pizza taste testers, like those for Taste of Home, Insider, and of course right here at Mashed, rank Red Baron as middle of the road as far as flavor and consistency. Although an article published in Delish claims that the classic crust pepperoni pizza is one of the best options on the market. One thing's for sure, any pizza company that has staying power for over 40 years is doing something right. When pizza happens on a tiny bagel, that's a snack, not a meal, right? Well, according to an article in Ranker, that was the plan of two friends, Bob Mosher and Stanley Garzinski, in 1985 when they came up with the idea of Bagel Bites. Their idea and efforts were well rewarded when, after investing $20,000 into their product, they made $1 million in the first year of sales. That number just kept going up, $6 million in year two, and by 1987, they sold the brand to Canadian food company John Labatt, which later sold to Heinz in 1991, which started selling the snacks under the Ore-Ida name. The real genius in marketing came later when, in the late 90s, the brand started marketing to tweens rather than moms. With Tony Hawk as a spokesperson and a major marketing campaign during the 2000 Winter X Games, the company saw a 26% increase in consumption. In 1980, Pillsbury received a patent for the microwave susceptor, a product meant to turn frozen pizza crispy in just 2 to 3 minutes. The term microwave susceptor sounds strange, but it's something you're bound to be familiar with. It's the glossy, gray plastic surface that you place your microwavable pizza on in order to have it cook correctly.
Pizza?
Dude, we're gonna be late.
Relax.
Not in there. Get soggy, man.
Trust me.
Basically, the plastic film uses the radiation from the microwave to turn the susceptor surface into a mini oven, helping it to make breads crispy rather than soggy or doughy. The real winner in the use of this tool has been Hot Pockets. Without the microwave susceptor, it would be practically impossible to enjoy a Hot Pocket sandwich, given that the sleeves for the handheld pizzas serve both as crispers and hand protectors against the pocket's lava-hot contents.
It's not delivery, it's DiGiorno.
You can probably imagine the smiling faces in the DiGiorno advertisements at the very mention of its slogan, after the Kraft Foods company devised a rising crust frozen pizza for the home. For years, the frozen pizza business couldn't hold a candle to pizzeria pizzas, because the crust just didn't compare. But according to an article published in the New York Times, DiGiorno's introduction of rising crust revolutionized the frozen pizza business in 1995. The new crust came about after Kraft Foods was inspired to use patents taken out in 1983 by General Foods of White Plains. Kraft acquired this company and its patents in 1989, and by combining the information from these patents with modified packaging designed to prevent the erosion of dough, the newer, more pizzeria-like frozen pizza crust was born. The proof of the product's success is in the pudding. In the 2 years following DiGiorno's 1995 debut, frozen pizza sales increased by $500 million, and DiGiorno continues to be the best-selling brand today. Pizza may have its roots in Italy, but North Americans have more than fully adopted the food and, given the popularity of regional styles of pizza, have done what they could to make it an American food tradition. This is further emphasized by the fact that, according to a February 2016 article published in the Orlando Sentinel, after Halloween, Super Bowl Sunday is the second biggest day of the year for pizza sales. And the big game is definitely a purely American event. But it's not just pizza delivery that's popular in North America. Frozen pizza is in incredibly high demand. According to a press release by Allied Market Research, North America had the largest market share of frozen pizza sales in terms of value, and is expected to continue to grow between 2017 and 2023. So unless Europeans up their frozen pizza consumption game, they may just have to give credit where credit is due. Pizza is practically as American as apple pie. Even though DiGiorno's thick rising crust pizza turned into a boon for the frozen pizza industry, it's actually thin crust that accounts for the highest market share worldwide. This is according to a press release put out by Allied Market Research in 2018. The release went on to explain that the reduced calories and carbs in thin crust pizzas were seen as being healthier options than stuffed and deep dish style pizza crusts. This focus on health also helps explain the popularity of a new type of frozen pizza crust on the market, a cauliflower-based crust. First, cauliflower is a vegetable, so anytime you can add more veggies to your diet, you can view it as a win, right? Especially if those vegetables are disguised as part of a pizza. Plus, cauliflower crusts don't have the highly processed carbohydrates of a traditional pizza crust, so people on low-carb or keto-style diets are more likely to be drawn to frozen pizzas that cut their carbs in this manner. According to a 2017 article in Food Navigator USA, the brand Cauliflower's gluten-free frozen pizza crusts were on schedule to be available in 6,500 stores worldwide by the end of October of that year, and could be found in stores ranging from Walmart and Kroger to online retailers like Amazon. Check out one of our newest videos right here! Plus, even more MASH videos about your favorite eats are coming soon. Subscribe to our YouTube channel and hit the bell so you don't miss a single one.